Hi, this is Charles Anderson again. This is my second video showing some of the basics of Aspen Custom Modeler. So let me just jump straight in. This is, in this case, what I'm going to try and do is show you how to start building a model, running it and interacting with it a little bit. So in the first video, I spoke about the structure of the windows, how the simulation explorer is set up. And so that's a good starting point. This time what I'm going to do is I'm going to open up a file that I prepared earlier and allow you to see how that's structured. So if you recall, in the Explorer window over here in the libraries, in the previous demo I only had two open, the modeler and the system library. Those are the two that come out of the box with Aspen. What you can see here is that this is my library where I've come in and I've created a series of unit operation models and various other bits and pieces, streams and so on. One thing I forgot to mention in the previous video was structures. I've mentioned global variables. A structure is a little bit like a global variable. So if you remember, a global variable is where you would set the value of pi or the pressure of steam in your system. In this case, a structure is where you have that sort of global variable, but you want to group together multiple different related concepts. So they're typically used for things like reaction kinetics, or in my case, physical properties. So what I want to do is make sure that I'm using the same physical properties in each stream in the model so that I get the same density in each of those streams. And if I want to change it, I want to change it in only one place rather than having to work through my whole model and correct it. So that's what I've done here. I've created a structure holder that declares various variables, arrays, and sets things up. So with that structure in place, I then instantiate elements of that structure that show up here in the flowsheet structures. So you can see I've created two structures. One I've called props, which is the general one I'm going to use for my streams and most of my models. But I've also created one called water. I'm going to use that for the case where I've got cooling water or steam. So I just have a single component in that stream. And so that's going to let me do things slightly differently there. So with that props, you'll see that I can come in and I can look at the properties that I've configured, the inputs that I've chosen to highlight and pull out. And so you see I'm declaring some component lists first, and then there's various parameters that get defined. Those component lists, if you recall, sit up here in the component lists, and you can see that now I've created several. Component lists in ACM come in two flavors. There's either what they call a set, and that's just a list of names, and that's going to be for components that you're going to declare the physical properties for yourself. The second option is that you declare them as a list, and in that case, you're going to have to link to an Aspen properties file. That Aspen properties file is going to contain the various elements, the various components that you can model, and it's also going to have, you know, you can use different physical property methods and models for those different steps, and you've got different options in terms of the number of iterations and the tolerances to which it's going to solve and that sort of thing. So in this case, I've declared I'm going to use Aspen, glucose, and water from the physical properties file I set up earlier, and my default, I'm also going to have air and ammonia. So this air and ammonia are going to be declared locally. So in my properties structure, you can see for air and ammonia, I am declaring some parameters to do vapor pressure and various other bits and pieces coming through there. You'll also notice glucose shows up as a vapor pressure because I chose to separate Aspen properties from Aspen VLE properties. So what I'm doing in this case is the way I've structured my model is I'm going to use Aspen physical properties for things like density and viscosity of the three components. But for vapor liquid equilibrium, I'm going to take glucose out of the mix and I'm going to create my own simplified model of glucose, and I'm going to say its vapor pressure is 10 to the minus 14. In other words, it's not volatile at all. But I'm going to take it out of the Aspen physical properties calculation. That's just going to make things easier to converge later on. Okay, so I've got my components, I've got my structure set up, now I can start building my model. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to grab a stream, I'm going to call it base stream. By default, Aspen is going to give it a name. I can change that by coming to Tools, Settings, and force it to allow me to name things if I want to. I typically operate in that mode, so that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to then bring in a tank. I'm going to drop the tank on the flow sheet. And you see now I have to name the tank before I can put it on, so I'm going to call this creatively tank 1. You can see when I did drop that tank on, I get this little red triangle down here telling me that the model is 9 degrees of freedom underspecified. I'll explain what that means in just a moment, but let me just show you that when I connect a stream up to that input port, it recognizes that it now knows what its feed flow and composition and temperature is. So now the problem is square again. It knows how to solve it. It's got the right number of fixed and free variables. And so if I hit run, it now converges, and you can see very quickly gives me a solution. So some of the other things to talk about now. So with these, every block and every stream, when I declared them, the all variables table is one that surprisingly enough contains all variables. That is automatically generated, and that shows you everything that's potentially in the stream. You can also then customize those elements and create your own subset of everything. You don't necessarily always want to see everything. So if I now double click on the stream, you'll see rather than having, if I right click forms all variables, you see I get this giant table with lots and lots and lots of variables declared. I've pulled out the ones that I think are most interesting. This helps me configure the model, get the key results out of it, that sort of thing. The same is true for the stream. That comes in and tells me, the flow rate, temperature, and pressure that I'm feeding material in, the composition of the feed stream, that sort of thing. Okay, so that is a very quick overview of how to start building models, dragging components onto the flow sheet and running. The last thing I want to show you is that every time you run the model, there's this thing called a snapshot that's generated. That snapshot tells you what the model was when you started, the initial specification, is it converged, yes or no. And then you have a steady state run that I've just performed, a steady state run. So that's always at time zero. It tells me I've just done it this evening, and yes, it has converged. So this is a useful starting point if I want to come back and use it to either keep a particular result that was interesting to me, or one of the things about Aspen Custom Modeler is because it's solving the equations using a Newton method, it's setting up a large matrix of variables. And that can sometimes be difficult to converge if you don't have a reasonable initial estimate. And so this is a way of storing that reasonable initial estimate so that if something goes wrong, you can come back and reload that starting point and hopefully get your model to converge again and then move more slowly to the new operating point that you're interested in. Okay, again, a lot of information all thrown at you. I'm going to stop for now and then come back and do another short recording for the next bit. Thank you very much.